This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And I'm here with Rav Arora. Now, some of you will have known his name because you probably listen to Glenn Loury and other people. He's been on these podcasts. He is a very, very young man. I think, Rav, are you 20?
Yes, 20.
Okay. So he's 20. And he's written a lot for the New York Post, Quillette, other places. He's Canadian, and he stays well outside of his lane, whatever that means. I've known him for about a year or so. You know, we've corresponded, and most people his age obviously are not writing for the New York Post. They are not going on Glenn Lowry's podcast. So I would say he's reasonably accomplished. He's put himself out there. He's not afraid to express his opinions. Most of you probably who know of him have read his work on policy, on social affairs of the United States. We're not here actually to talk about that. We're here to talk about something kind of different, something I don't know too much about, but I've heard a lot about it. And so I am here mostly to ask questions because Rav has a new Substack on, talk about your Substack. Talk about what you're talking about, because it's a little bit outside of the box compared to what I know you from.
Sure. Yeah. So you want me to talk about my background briefly?
You can talk about your background and then go into the Substack.
Sure. Yeah. My background, I'm 20, as you said, and I graduated high school in 2019. And then I kind of took a year off to kind of figure out what I wanted to do. And I'd always been a writer, and I'd always been a somebody who's been closely following the current cycle of the news, and particularly racial issues and relating to criminal justice and other identity politics issues. And so right around when George Floyd happened, I started writing about racial issues, and the New York Post accepted one of my articles on white privilege, and that went viral, and a lot of people were reading it. And after that, I just started consistently writing about racial issues, criminal justice for, as you mentioned, Quillette, City Journal, The Globe and Mail, and other places. So I've been doing that for about, it's been a couple of years now. I've been doing that, a year and a half. And a few weeks ago, about a month ago at this point, I launched my new Substack, which is dedicated to explorations into psychedelic therapy, meditation, spirituality, Eastern mysticism, and everything kind of in between.
Yeah, so just for the listeners out there who don't know me, I'm pretty much a straight edge person. Psychedelics, I don't know. That's a little bit outside of my my pay grade, but a lot, I have friends who are into psychedelics and mysticism and this sort of thing. I am not a mystical person. I'm pretty old school materialist, and I am pretty straight edge. I do drink, but I don't do, all the other things. So I don't know anything about this, Rav. Why is this a big deal? Why am I hearing about this constantly now? Because you're not the first person that's brought this up with me, and people have asked me, like, have you explored psychedelics to get in touch with your spiritual side? No matter what side is that, so can you talk about that?
Sure. Yeah. So the reason why everybody's talking about it is, I really hate to say this because it sounds a little hyperbolic, but it is the closest thing to a silver bullet or a miracle cure or a one-size-fits-all solution, an incredible tool for exploring yourself. It is something that, like I said, it's comes as close as possible to kind of a silver bullet for healing a whole range of things. So healing deep psychological traumas, learning about yourself, building connection with others and with your surroundings, having a renewed gratitude for life, reducing chronic depression PTSD, and we can talk about those specifically, anxiety, OCD, opioid addiction, smoking addiction, and then mystically speaking, sort of developing a connection with something beyond. I mean, there are many surveys showing that that around 60 to 70% of atheists who have a single or two sessions of psilocybin, 70% no longer identify with the term atheist after their experience, because they've been exposed to this different dimension, this different realm of being that is so different from what they ever have experienced before, that they now have this renewed appreciation for, like, okay, maybe, you know, there is no second coming or the apocalypse or, you know, whatever this religious bullshit is, but there is a mystical realm. There is an experience that is very different from our ordinary waking consciousness that we can tap into, that helps us lose this kind of rigid attachment to this world. And I know that sounds a little unhinged, but by that I mean many of these psychedelic explorations help people to detach themselves from, like, the outcomes of life. Like, if you're chasing after this thing, or if you're pursuing something, there's people have this tendency to rigidly attach themselves to what's going to happen with what they do. And as you know, Razib, you're many years older than I am. As you know, you set out to do something, and obviously you want it to happen the way you intended, but many times it doesn't happen, whether romantically, socially, economically, in terms of your career, you don't get the dream job you wanted, or this girl that you loved didn't love you back, and then you're devastated afterwards. But through these psychedelic explorations, and I'm using very broad terms here, we can pinpoint some of these specific things that I've talked about, but that's just one thing that people gain from these psychedelic experiences, is a renewed gratitude for what they have, and less of a fixation on the outcomes of their actions rather than their actions themselves.
Yeah, so I'm curious about this research that you're talking about, and like, I've never heard of it, but it sounds interesting. I mean, but don't you think that people who identify as atheists, the type who would go to do that sort of study, are self-selected?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, but the thing is, like, I know many people who are atheists and have no spiritual component to their life, but they're sort of forced to, socially pressured into doing it, or they're just curious about it and they just end up doing it. And then their preconceived notions about mysticism are totally shattered, and they end up having a renewed or a new appreciation for something beyond just the physical realm.
Yeah, so let's get to definitions, like spirituality, mysticism. Like, what does this mean?
Sure. This is all subjective by nature, right? We're not talking about something that you can scientifically measure, although researchers have tried in many ways. But by spirituality, we mean an exploration or appreciation for something beyond just the physical realm, beyond just our five senses, beyond just our waking consciousness, beyond just our ego. That seems to be a central part of it, of experiencing something that transcends our cravings, desires, our yearnings, our various obsessions in life. You know, many people who have these mystical experiences, whether or not it's through psychedelics or through prayer or chanting or meditation, it's a kind of state where you're no longer endlessly chasing after whatever your ego wants, whether that's related to food, sex, any kind of economic endeavors that you're pursuing. This is a kind of state where you can learn to kind of transcend those things. And I know, you know, feel free to ask more about this, but I know this sounds very bizarre to people who've never experienced this. So it's really a matter of experience here. And I think that's a really important part of this, is this sort of way we're conditioned for obvious reasons to conceptualize everything in our world and use our rational thinking brain. And that's obviously how we navigate the world. That's how we finish degrees and get jobs and have social relationships. But there's this other side of just sort of experiencing in a very non-rationalistic way, just experiencing life. That's kind of what happens in these psychedelic experiences, is they can't be quantified or like statistically measured or you know, really rigidly rationalized. It's something more subjective. It's something that goes deeper than any kind of thing you can measure with an instrument. Like many people talk about how words are blunt instruments that you can't even really use to describe these experiences because of how profound, transcendent, and out of the ordinary they are.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little so it's a little difficult, obviously, to put into words, and you know, and I've heard other people say this, read things like this. So it's, you know, Ludwig Wittgenstein said sometimes you can't like talk about something or describe it, but you can try to whistle it. So it's kind of like the ineffable truths, the intuitions, the hunches people have. So, you know, you said it's not quantifiable and you have to experience it. So I guess my question is then, okay, if it's not quantifiable and you have to experience it as a non-mystically oriented person, I guess, why do people talk about it all the time? Why are there books about it? You know, because like those seem to be like kind of concrete, like rational things. Shouldn't this be a situation where you just kind of like show people, they follow you by emulation? Do you understand what I'm trying to get at?
Yeah. Can you hear me, by the way, still?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, yeah. So the experience here is at the key. And by quantify, I mean so we can also get into some of the studies in a second with relation to depression, PTSD. There they have they have quantified their findings, obviously, and they've done these long-term or short-term clinical trials, and they show some very robust, profound findings with respect to various mental disorders. But on just the experience, like it's you obviously can describe it as best as possible. It's a difficult job, but it's, you know, you can sort of look at it in terms of the outcome. Like most people who have these experiences, the vast majority of people who have these experiences seem to have something that is very profound, where they say that this is one of the top three most profound experiences of their lives. This is what surveys show. This is what anecdotally people say. And I know you said that you've talked to people about this, and I'm sure they sort of evangelically talk about this. Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, they want to share, they want to talk about it. It depends. Like some people, they're quite private about it. And then other people are more evangelical. Sure. So it just depends on the person, you know? Sure. And it's obviously like very private and personal thing for a lot of people. So it's not like, basically what I'm trying to say is, okay, this is like a kind of a mode of religiosity or maybe of like religious experience, mysticism, sure, that is different from say, oh, the Nicene Creed or the Shahada. It's not like a very specific profession of faith, orthodoxy, or it's not even like a rule following legal cultural system of liturgy. It's something that's very internal, and it's a mental state that you achieve. And how do you get to that mental state? That's what you're saying, right? And a lot of people have gotten to that mental state, through self-denial, maybe through fasting. There are people who do lots of sports.
Meditation.
Meditation. You achieve this mental state, clarity. People talk about clarity. So for example, silent meditation. Sure. Or a silent retreat, yep. These sorts of things. These are common. But now you're talking about psychedelics, right? And so what do you say to someone that would say, you know, that's a shortcut. Like taking a drug is a shortcut. Like you should fast. You should do something natural that doesn't include taking some random, you know, chemical.
Right. First of all, in terms of the religion part of it, I think is important here because taking these medicines, and I do use the word medicine here very specifically. I've never used this in a party situation. I've only done it in, and we can talk more about this if you want, but I've only done this in guided settings with a trained psychotherapist or a psychologist working with me and administering the drug and then helping me interpret the experience afterwards and integrating it into my life. But these substances are very powerful and kind of metaphysically or religiously neutral. So you, unlike participating in some kind of devotional practice at the church, there are no any beliefs required in order to participate in this experience, right? It's not, you don't have to believe in Jesus or Krishna or the Buddha or whatever. You just take it and you just have the experience, which I think is very powerful, because you can achieve these altered states of consciousness that your brain is already capable of doing through various other means, but you're sort of doing it in the shortcut way, which is what you just asked me about here. And this is one of the critiques that many religious people have, is that this is a kind of artificial way of doing this. But there is a kind of a naturalist argument here of many people say that these, you know, psilocybin mushrooms, for example, they're all natural. They were planted here on the earth, and various ancient cultures have used them, which is something that I'm going to start to explore some of the historical context of these things. It's a really fascinating realm of research. But it's if you're not a religious person, there really should be no objection here. With religious people, it's sort of like they don't want you to experience something through the drug that can be institutionally experienced in this very formal, religiously contextualized setting at the church or at the mosque or at the temple or whatever. But these are, you know, in your brain, these are just, you know, neurotransmitters. These are just chemicals in your brain. Whether a drug does it or whether, you know, fasting for a week can produce hallucinations, long-term meditation retreats, chanting, various breathing techniques, holotropic breathing can do this. It's all just a matter of chemicals that these various experiences elicit, and psychedelics just happen to be safe, effective, not requiring any religious or metaphysical beliefs. And so it can be done safely and effectively in the proper condition. So it provides a very powerful way for people who aren't religious to have an experience that goes beyond what they're living in their day-to-day existence. And I think it's also important to go into some of the specific compounds like MDMA and psilocybin, and I'll let you interject if you want to say something about it, but I think it's important.
What I'm going to interject is for a lot of us listening out there, psilocybin, MD, I mean, okay, all I know about it is they kind of, the words kind of scare me, okay? Because, I mean, okay, drugs, just say no. I mean, a lot of us have that reaction. And so why is this different? You're using, obviously, cocaine, heroin, these were, you know, were drugs or still are drugs, you know, morphine, these sorts of things. You know, people can addict it to painkillers, but painkillers are important, right? So can you differentiate the positive and the negative before I move on to the positive and what they do in a mystical sense?
Sure. Like in terms of talk about the side effects potentially?
Yeah, the side effects, like, you know, like abuse, like, is there abuse?
Sure.
You know, like, I mean, sure. Like, as I said, like, I don't know much about psychedelics personally at all. They're just words in the news and I don't read about them because they don't affect me, to be honest.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. And this is, and there's a lot of biographical story here with respect to me and how I got into this. And this was one of the things early on that was something that I was researching pretty rigorously, was the safety profile of these things. And just briefly, the reason why I got into this in the first place was due to a series of traumatic events and psychological issues that I was experiencing, and I won't go into the specific detail, but these things, various issues that had emerged in my life over the past several years in childhood, especially, and then in my teenage years. And I was looking for solutions. I was looking for therapies that would help me. And I tried many things, meditation, counseling, breath work. And some of it was just sort of a spiritual yearning too, was sort of like, sort of being interested, just naturally very interested about sort of altered states of consciousness as well. So it was various negative experiences that I had compounded with these interests I had in altered states of consciousness, which I learned a lot about in my own home with my mom and my dad being of Hindu and Sikh background, and hearing a lot about these altered states of consciousness through various yogic and meditative practices. But as somebody myself who's not religious in the slightest, I always was not interested in participating in any of those kind of things. But then as time went on, I realized, like, this isn't just bullshit. This isn't just superstition. Like, there are, like, I know so many people who through these, you know, in the Hindu or the Buddhist context, have had these powerful mystical experiences that have improved their lives and have transformed them, have given them renewed sense of gratitude, have reduced depression and anxiety and obsessiveness. And then looking at all of that, that's backed by some of the clinical literature of through surveys and through actual clinical trials and through many people who've talked about this, I just became interested in getting into this. And so I started doing some research, and then the first thing that came up was like, okay, like if I'm going to do this, you know, I've also been conditioned in this environment of say no to drugs, because drugs are harmful. And in my high school and middle school years, I never smoked marijuana or cigarettes or drank or vaped or did any of those things. And I was taught not to. So this had to pass a really high bar of safety for me to get involved. And so I started doing the research, and it turns out these are, for the vast majority of people, non-addictive substances. That's what the clinical literature shows. It's very difficult for people to become addicted to psilocybin, and even MDMA, although MDMA is a little different. It's used as a party drug. But in these clinical settings, when you're doing MDMA, and I could talk about my experience in a bit, it's after having experienced this myself and of reading the clinical literature on MDMA therapy, it's obvious that once you do one session with a therapist, it's very difficult to go back to that session right away and do it again because of so much trauma that comes up, which we can talk about. But these things are non-addictive, and I'm not sure what exactly the neurophysiological basis for that is, but I've heard of many researchers at Johns Hopkins, including Roland Griffiths and Rick Doblin, the founder of MAPS, talk about how the psychedelics seem to work outside of the dopamine system. And so they've done animal studies on this as well, like with rats, for example. It's very easy to get them hooked on cocaine and other substances, but it's very difficult for them to get hooked on psilocybin or MDMA for whatever strange reason. So these things are non-addictive, and I think the from a subjective point of view, at least, the reason for that is the experience is so overwhelming. And for many people, it can be, well, it depends how you do it. But in a clinical setting, for some people, it can be terrifying as well, or very difficult to experience those things because certain things about themselves tend to emerge, or people who've witnessed a lot of trauma, a lot of those traumas reemerge. And so you can't really be addicted to revisiting your trauma or visiting the dark parts of yourself. That's not a very pleasant thing to do. But so that's kind of, well, where things are at with safety. Mm-hmm. It's not addictive, and for psilocybin, there's basically no fatal dose, which is remarkable. And it's Matt Johnson, researcher at Johns Hopkins, has talked about how psilocybin and MDMA are safer than many drugs you get from pharmacies, because they have, which is remarkable, very little side effects. The only warnings that are legitimate are that people who have schizophrenia in the family should most likely avoid it. People who have psychosis should also avoid it. You definitely want to do your own research. If you have any kind of clinical diagnosis, you should talk to your psychologist or your psychiatrist and do your research before doing these things. Having certain mental disorders can make one less safe in doing these experiences. However, other mental disorders like PTSD, depression, anxiety, OCD is in fact a greater reason to do these experiences, not less. If you're suffering from chronic depression, you are a much better candidate for doing psilocybin than somebody who's living a relatively happy, fulfilled life. So that's kind of a very brief overview in terms of the safety profile there.
Okay, I mean, that really clears a lot of things up. I guess like one thing that I'm wondering about now is, before I was talking to you and your Substack, and you know, your focus here is like mysticism and psychedelics, but I mean, it sounds almost like therapy and psychedelics. I mean, like where's the border here? Like, how are you defining these things? Like, what's the difference?
Right. Yeah. Well, so again, I got interested in this because of the therapy part of it. And I described some of my issues very vaguely. And also just the spiritual part of it, which I'm very curious about, you know, like just from a spiritual angle, like why is it that so many people who've been on long-term meditation retreats come back and have this incredible gratitude and have this mindfulness that they didn't have before, where they're able to enjoy even the little things in life? You know, I look at so many people around me who've done meditation retreats, and also people who've had psilocybin experiences who've told me about this. And as somebody myself who is a very kind of restless, incessantly thinking, obsessive, very obsessive person who holds on to things and who relentlessly chases after things, whether it's career, whether it's romance or friendships, and some of that is actually a blessing. That's kind of what's led to some of these accomplishments so far in my career, is me just relentlessly pursuing after various things. But on the other hand, it's kind of a curse, because when things don't go my way in any aspect of life, I get devastated and depressed very easily. Mm-hmm. I'm always sort of subconsciously kind of postponing my happiness to some future goal. And this is a universal thing. So many people do this. And I think now is also the right point to also bring in sort of my key inspiration here, which was Sam Harris, whose work I started getting into a couple years ago. And he has a meditation app, which is phenomenal. And if anybody's struggling with anxiety or depression, or are just subjectively just dealing with kind of restlessness and a lack of stability in their mental lives, then I highly recommend you check out his app. So I started looking into his app, and you know, you know of Sam's work, I'm sure. I don't know if you've talked to him before, but he's mm-hmm. an atheist individual.
Yeah.
But he has an appreciation for mystical experience that he acquired at 18 and 19 years of age, when he had a few mind-blowing revelatory MDMA and mushroom experiences that revealed to him that there are altered states of consciousness. When you have these experiences, they serve as a reference point for something that you should integrate more and more into your life. And so with his MDMA experience, he talks about feelings of boundless joy and unconditional love that is very difficult to kind of access in your normal waking life. And so once you have that experience, it's not just that you are gonna, it's a, you know, with MDMA, it's a euphoric experience, and what many people describe, including Sam, is you feel this unconditional love for other people, without any kind of transactional reason. So it's not that this person gives you something and you feel love. It's just that you want good things to happen to everybody for no reason at all. And you even want that for your enemies and people who've done wrong to you. This is the experience people have typically on MDMA. And they feel this intense gratitude and appreciation for their lives that they didn't have before. So then it's a matter of, okay, what do you do with that experience? Like that's such a powerful experience that is very difficult to achieve in normal waking consciousness. And so after these experiences, what people like Sam Harris have discovered is that you can integrate these experiences more and more into your waking life, that these serve as kind of ethical and also like experiences that have an ethical and moral valence as well. Of like, oh, there is a state here where you can just love other people without asking for anything in return. Or you can feel compassion for people who've done wrong to you. Even the worst things possible, you can't have compassion for them. So that's a very profound insight that, again, it's very difficult to achieve that in any normal waking consciousness. So these experiences provide they help enforce a kind of moral foundation. And this is where Jordan Peterson's work on psychedelics is relevant here too. He's talked about how he's seen many patients in his clinical practice and in his research, he's seen so many of these case studies of people who have two or three like psilocybin and MDMA sessions, and it provides them with a moral compass that they didn't have before that never went away. That's a direct quote from Jordan Peterson. So that's just like mind blowing. Like that's so incredible. And then, like I was saying earlier, like I don't want to oversell this at all. I don't want to exaggerate or hyperbolize any of this stuff at all, but it seems to be that these experiences drastically improve people's lives and ethically inform their engagement with the world and with other people. I can also speak to some of my experiences in a second if you want with MDMA and some of the studies showing the efficacy against PTSD and depression, because all of that is very relevant as well.
Yeah, I mean, so I want to talk about that. I want to get to that. One thing I want to say though is like, or suggest, is you're talking about people and their reactions. And I mean, it sounds like to me, this is efficacious for a lot of people, but I do think we need to keep in mind that just because something is useful and relevant for some people, it doesn't necessarily mean everybody, right? So like, for example, like, you know, saying, okay, you know, these people, you feel this moral compass, this sense of purpose, and I can believe that, but a lot of people don't do psychedelics and they have that, right? So I guess the analogy that I would use is, you know, I have a friend, actually I have several, unfortunately, who have issues with alcohol and, you know, they either don't drink or they're highly self-regulated. I myself am a just conventional social drinker during coronavirus when I wasn't interacting with people. I didn't drink for like a year and it wasn't a big deal. On the other hand, I have a friend and it's like a big deal when he doesn't drink in any given day and it's a struggle. So, you know, what's the difference here? I mean, you know, there's just, we know there's genetic dispositions, genetic differences. And so I can imagine a situation where, you know, some people, I mean, you know, there are people who are susceptible to depression for various reasons, sometimes trauma, sometimes they're just biologically, biochemically oriented that way. And so I do want to make a suggestion here that, you know, these psychedelics might be useful for a certain subset of people in certain contexts and maybe not for others. So as we're talking about this now, in terms of people and what they've done, why don't you like personalize it a little and talk about your experiences and what you've seen, what you felt, what you've experienced?
Sure. Yeah. And I think your caveats there are appropriate, that it's not everybody should take psychedelics. I would never say that. I don't think everybody listening to this podcast should just go and do it themselves. As I did it, and I'll talk about this in a second, it's something that I think has incredible healing potential. And because of that, it should only be done in settings that best promote healing. So being at a party, smoking weed and drinking and dancing all night is not an appropriate setting for healing. Okay. And so I encourage people to do guided experiences only. And there's a huge underground scene, basically in every big city at this point, for these guided psychedelic experiences. Usually, if anybody's interested, I'm here in Vancouver, and I didn't have much of a hard time finding somebody to do this with, somebody who I trusted and was experienced and had credentials and all of it. But if you just search up like psychedelic assisted therapy in whatever city you're living in, you can find clinics, mental health clinics that offer psychedelic assisted therapy, which is legal, which means that therapists and psychologists that help you interpret your psychedelic experiences, which they are not legally allowed to administer. But usually once you find your way into these clinics, you can seek out these guided experiences, which again is not formally advertised, but it is something that many therapists and psychologists offer in these kind of clinics. So in terms of my personal experience, so I'm actually in the process of writing about this right now, and I'm sort of keeping it low key at this point, in terms of just the broader reach. At some point I'll consider doing some other bigger podcasts and shows and doing bigger articles and stuff like that, going deeper into the very specific experiences. But basically what happened is I did MDMA therapy for my first session, and I did it with a guide, and it was about a 5-hour trip. And so I went to the clinic, and MDMA was administered, and it took about 45 minutes to kick in. And suddenly I just felt this kind of this lightheadedness and this feeling of euphoria. And then I laid down, closed my eyes, was wearing eye shades, and there was some light music in the background. And the therapist's job there is just to assure you at times, if you are feeling anxious, that everything is going to be fine. And also the therapist helps you interpret whatever is coming up in that experience. And it's very difficult to guide the experience yourself. Things just come up by themselves that you can't really control, which does sound kind of terrifying to certain people. But with MDMA, what happens is it decreases activity in your amygdala, which is the fear center of your brain, and it floods serotonin to your brain. And so that gives feelings of euphoria and joy and happiness and love. And it increases activity in your hippocampus, which is involved in memory processing. And so what that does is it allows your brain to better, more safely, and in a more warm and welcoming and loving kind of way, revisit any kind of traumas in your life. That's basically what those things translate to: the amygdala, the hippocampus, hippocampus and the serotonin. Is that's kind of clinically, if you want to look at it, that's kind of what happens in your brain. And so the MDMA kicked in for me, and then suddenly just so many things from the past emerged. And I won't go into specific detail, but with respect to being bullied, not having many friendships growing up, and romantic relationships that disintegrated, and various issues with parents and things like that, they all came up as they all emerged in this way that was very easy to visit. It did not require any kind of difficulty, and these experiences in your normal waking consciousness, like people who have PTSD, which we can talk about in a second, it's very difficult for them to revisit those experiences and make come to grips with them and accept them for what they are and to learn from them. That's very difficult to do once you witness some kind of trauma. Mm-hmm. But when you have the MDMA, you can very open-heartedly explore these things, these dark parts of your mind, these things that you've experienced, and come to grips with them. So a lot of these things came up of parents, of friendships, of romantic relationships. And I sort of realized the root cause of my suffering in many ways. And that's a common thing that comes up in the literature in case studies, is people identify a kind of root cause of their suffering. And again, at this point, I don't want to go into the exact specific details, but basically I sort of realized that a lot of my suffering right now in this point, a lot of the depression, the anxiety, and the obsessiveness was a kind of learned behavior early on in childhood from seeing my parents attract in a certain way and friendships that didn't work out and being bullied for so many different reasons in various ways. All of those experiences led me to kind of be in this state right now where I had sort of internalized this message that life is just about working and achieving things and just running on this constant treadmill, one thing after the other. And it's your happiness is contingent on career achievements, on relationships, working on achieving various things. Whereas there is a kind of deeper appreciation, a deeper kind of well-being that Sam Harris talks about, for example, that is kind of independent from whatever you achieve or don't achieve in your life. And then that's a common thing that many mystics and sages have spoken about throughout the ages, is this kind of level of equanimity and of well-being that you can maintain before anything good happens to your life, before you get the girlfriend or the wife or the house, or before you become rich and you achieve all these things. And for me, that's really powerful, because somebody this age who, objectively speaking, has accomplished a lot, I'm still sort of, and this is a kind of a spiritual crisis for me, is I'm always looking for the next thing and always jumping for the next thing to achieve. And I'm never able to be at peace with kind of what's in front of me right now. I'm never able to just be satisfied with what I've achieved in this moment. It's always about the next thing. And that's just not me. I'm sure many people listening to this can relate to that. And so the MDMA experience showed me that there is something deeper here. There is a way of being that is very different from what I've been conditioned to believe through these traumatic experiences since childhood. And so experiencing that was seriously like one of the most profound experiences of my life. I mean, in the past several years, probably the most profound experience that I've ever had. And I've been integrating that with a counselor afterwards and incorporating that into my meditation practice. And it's only given me sort of more hope for some of the issues with depression and anxiety that I've been facing. And so, yeah, it's a really powerful thing that is safe and effective and has helped so many people. So it's a great tool for healing these deep traumas.
Yeah. So, I hear that, and you're not the only person that has talked about this sort of thing, or, you know, I mean, obviously at length, this is the first conversation I probably had about this, but people have alluded to this before. But, you know, you're talking about like you and us, and it's kind of focused on the human individual and kind of repairing ourselves in a way. But what about psychedelics, like in terms of spirituality, metaphysics, mysticism? Do you think, do people who take psychedelics, do they get a sense of the world out there, like a deeper perception of objective reality?
Of objective reality?
Say reality.
Sorry, say that again. You just broke up there. You say objective reality?
Yeah, objective reality or just reality. I'm basically, sure. I want to close out the conversation by talking about, like, okay, so you take this stuff, and people have told me, like, it accesses different dimensions, all sorts of words, right? Like, what does that mean? Because that's obviously not about just, you know, like, there's drugs you take that affect you internally, and then there's, like, you know, this is a drug you take that also affects your perception of the world.
Okay, yeah. So beyond just the therapeutic effects, right? Yeah. Beyond, you're asking now beyond that.
Yes.
Yeah. So before I answer that, I should just also quickly say, like, with MDMA, it is the most effective treatment for PTSD at this point. A recent phase 3 trial showed that 67% of participants were cured of PTSD after three sessions of MDMA and the following psychotherapy with the counselor. Same thing with depression. One study of Johns Hopkins found that 67% of participants had a more than 50% reduction in depression symptoms at a 1 week follow-up after having done, I believe it was two or three sessions of psilocybin with psychotherapy. And 71% had 50% had a significant reduction in depression at a 4 week follow-up. And about half of participants were permanently cured of depression, which is incredible. So that's just two things in the clinical literature, which is mind-boggling for any psychiatrist. Like, this is far more effective than any antidepressant or any other drug that's out there in the market for PTSD or depression or smoking addiction or any of these other things. Okay, so in terms of the spiritual part of it, it's interesting. There's this I can't obviously quantify the way I just did with these research studies, and that poses kind of a challenge for me as a journalist, as well as somebody who is very rational, who is very statistics oriented. And it's interesting, most people who know my work know me as somebody who brings kind of facts to the conversation with respect to race, criminal justice, and these woke issues where the far left has totally abandoned objective reality in favor of all these, you know, multiplicity of interpretations, and have gone into all these abstractions and all these esoteric left-wing academic theories, and they're not actually looking at things, they're not actually understanding how human behavior works and actually looking at policies that work with respect to, like, criminal justice and, like, releasing offenders and holding criminals accountable for their actions and all these things. So that's kind of like the crux of my work is bringing kind of reality to this, to many of these hot button subjects surrounding race and identity that have been so devoid of objective reality. But I don't think you can just live your life fully in this objective thinking, mathematical, scientific realm, right? That's kind of where I've been, you know, kind of my whole life at this point. And I know I'm young, obviously, but this is kind of where I had the spiritual yearning of, like, I'm hearing all these people, whether it's in the religious, whether it's in Hinduism and Buddhism, studying some of those texts, which I'm doing right now in university, studying Theravada Buddhism and the history of psychedelics as well. Like people are having these experiences, spiritual, religious, or even atheistic people like Sam Harris, who I'm very inspired by, who, by the way, I also just recently interviewed on my Substack, if people want to check that out, at length, talking about meditation, about suffering, about fantasies and achieving goals and all those interesting things from a very spiritual perspective that Sam brings. But with these experiences, it's people commonly describe having a psilocybin or a DMT experience, which they feel like is more real than reality itself. So many people describe that. I'm sure you've heard of that at some point, which at this point for me in this stage, I don't know what to make of that because I've never experienced it. But it seems to result in at least one good behavioral outcome. And then this is something that I'll use Joe Rogan as an example. He talks about having done DMT several times, and he's far from anything religious. He totally rejects religious dogma, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism. He's somebody that, you know, has many people on and has a very rational discourse, as many people know. But he's had these DMT experiences that he says, in effect, make him realize that a lot of these issues, a lot of these Twitter wars and beefs online and these aversions and hatred towards other people and all these various conflicts in life are incredibly trivial. That's kind of one of the things that he said he experienced in some of his DMT experiences, where he access something beyond his physical realm. And he said he, this is a common experience with DMT, is you experience these other entities. He describes it as these court jesters. Many people call it the machine elves. That's what Terence McKenna described it as, these machine elves. And so, and Rogan talks about how these court jesters were looking at him with the middle finger and communicating to him that he's taking himself too seriously. And then, and these mystical beings were communicating to him that he needs to take life a little less seriously. And obviously that what I just said there, I even my own rationalistic mind seems to want to reject that whole idea, because that could be a dangerous thing to experience, of wanting to experience, wanting to take life a little less seriously. You know, we can think about various ways in which that could be a negative thing. But for many people, including myself, many people who have achieved great things in the world, who are very disciplined, ambitious, and are achieving many things and are holding themselves accountable, like Joe Rogan, it can be very profound to access something beyond just the physical realm that informs you to be less obsessively attached to people and things in this world. That seems to be a universal theme in the contemplative literature in Buddhism and Hinduism and in the psychedelic literature, is that through these spiritual or mystical experiences, you access something that is so beyond what you experience in your day-to-day life, that it diminishes some of the obsessiveness that you hold to achieving various things. And again, as I said earlier, the problem is that we all set out to achieve various things. We set goals, we try very hard, but many of the times we don't get there. And so people like myself struggle with actually embracing whatever the outcome is. And obviously there's room for improvement and of doing things differently, but even if you put in your maximum effort, there are certain things that are just not going to go your way. Tragedies are going to hit your life. People are going to die around you. Your loved ones will eventually die. So many negative experiences are out there. And so these mystical experiences that people have tend to diminish the magnitude of which suffering is, suffering affects your life in various ways through various tragedies. So that seems to be a common denominator in these experiences, which I think is very powerful.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, talking to you, it's interesting because, you know, you keep using the word experience. So obviously, you know, we spent a fair amount of time talking here, and, you know, there's going to be more talk about, you know, MDMA and psilocybin, whatever, these, you know, psychedelics. There's gonna be more talk about it. People are gonna read about it. They're gonna talk about it. You have convinced me that, or, you know, I have thought about it deeply, but I don't know if I'm gonna try them ever, but obviously they're not dangerous. They're not cocaine. They're not LSD. So I think that this is gonna be something that's on our cultural radar. Now here in the United States, excuse me, we're legalizing marijuana. It's all over the place. You can smell it. So, you know, this isn't the 20th century. It's not the 1990s. It's not the 1980s. I don't know where we're going with this, but I think we do need to engage with it. And I really appreciate you coming on and, you know, I mean, legitimately educating me, because I, you know, these are one of the things that people talk to me about, and I just kind of tune them out because it's not my deal. But, you know, I think you're a serious person, and you're trying to make a serious case here that we do need to take this seriously. And there are a lot of people, my generation in particular, you know, we were raised a certain way to think about psychedelics and drugs, mind-altering drugs in general. And maybe we need to update our views. So, Rava, thank you for your, you know, time. And it was a great conversation. Could you remind the listeners about your Substack again?
Yeah, so yeah, I should briefly talk about that here. The Substack is this new project for me in which it's going to be a mix of doing a lot of deep investigative reporting into the current clinical studies that are being done with a whole host of substances ranging from DMT and psilocybin and MDMA, looking at all sorts of psychological disorders. So I'm going to be investing a lot of time and energy into that. And so that's why I've created the Substack to help start financially supporting me in this new endeavor, which is very important. And that's why paid subscribers are important, so I can invest more and more time into doing a lot of this research and talking to people within the industry, because it is very difficult to access, and it is not something that you can just do sort of online through a computer. These things require access to these therapies, which are very expensive. And so that's kind of where I'm also intending to bring my readers on this kind of long-term journey with myself. Is I'm going to put myself in these positions and have these experiences. I've already done MDMA once, and I'm putting out an essay. I think by the time people listen to this podcast, they can find my essay on microdosing psilocybin, having a microdose of psilocybin, and my experiences with that, of heightened mindfulness and of awareness and of gratitude and all of that. And so in my future explorations are going to be in a second session of MDMA that I'm going to be doing soon, and then eventually a full session of psilocybin, and eventually DMT for the next couple of years. Just various firsthand experiences that I want to come back and share with the readers what I experienced, and inform them in their decisions, and potentially change some people's minds, bring other people who may be skeptical along with the journey. So this is going to be a process of self-discovery that I think is going to be immensely useful for many readers who, like myself, like yourself, who are not religious, who are not sort of mystical in their traditional ways, but at least in my case, spiritually curious, inquisitive about these altered states of consciousness and of also, like we've talked about, of healing these deep wounds, healing depression, anxiety, which there are really no effective treatments for at this point. And these psychedelic therapies done in the proper settings seem to offer a lot of therapeutic potential. So I encourage people to subscribe to the Substack and become a paid subscriber if you can, to help fund some of this deep investigative work. And also, I should say that none of this is going to replace my usual social commentary, the New York Post, on criminal justice and racial issues. All of that is going to be going on, and that's going to be my focus. But this is going to be a new project that I want to explore for the mental health purposes, and also just for the mystical and spiritual side of things, which I feel like in our culture is not emphasized enough. And so I want to explore that in great depth.
All right. Okay. Well, it was great talking to you, Rav. And I wish you the best of luck on this new endeavor and all the different things you do. I think a lot to chew on and think about from this conversation. So thank you again.
All right. Thanks.
This podcast for kids.